hospitality as well, so thank you very much. I've called my talk Metaphors of Translation, The View from Machine Translation. But before I get stuck into machine translation, I thought it would be best if I try to situate myself, tell you where I'm coming from. So I suppose the first thing to say is that for the past number of years, I've been conducting research into corpus-based translation studies. So you might know that corpora are large electronic collections of text. So basically, the studies that I have been doing of translation style, for example, have been based on processes or analyses that you can do if you have electronic text. So that's a bit of my research background. I'm also, as I know a number of you are, very heavily involved in translator training. And I understand there are a lot of students here today, so you're all involved in translation training as well. And as part of that, I teach translation technology. So I teach translators how to use technologies like translation memory softwares, how to use machine translation software, etc. I also teach terminology. I teach translation practice, from German into English mostly. And I say all of this, one, to tell you what my background is, but also to make it clear that I am not hostile to machine translation. You know, it's a process, well, it's a technology that's integrated in a lot of translation workflows, and it's very important. Okay, so I'm not hostile to it, per se. One of the things, though, that for me is interesting is that corpora, electronic collections of texts, have, over the past decade, if you like, become the unifying factor in my teaching and my research. Yeah? This is because all contemporary translation technologies are based on corpora. Okay? There is little new development work being done in rule-based machine translation, for example, for people who are familiar with machine translation paradigms. Terminology extraction, the extraction of definitions, etc. It's all based on electronic corpora. And in translation practice, I know that some of the other speakers in this session will be talking about how corpora are integrated into translator training. And there's good evidence from the profession that professional translators are now putting together their own corpora and helping with, or using corpora to help with continued professional development. So corpora feature everywhere, okay? They're very important to me. But they've also become the site of a conflict. I use this in my research and in my teaching, but one of the things that's become very evident over the last number of years is that as bilingual corpora, in other words, as source texts and their translations, as performed by human beings like me and you, as they become input to machine translation processes, I become slightly conflicted, and I'll explain that. Okay, so I've said what corpora are. Parallel corpora are basically source texts aligned with their translations. Okay, there are lots of well-known examples. I won't mention very many of them. The first one in the list there is the English-Norwegian parallel corpus, which was an early corpus used in corpus-based translation studies. Europarl is a corpus that is very familiar to people working in machine translation, so in automatic translation. It's a corpus of European Parliament proceedings, and it's available in 11 languages. So, often, well, no, you would know what the source language is for any one speaker, but you have 11 or 10 other versions of the same speech. It's a very useful resource. The first, or the corpora in the first bullet there, the European, or the English-Norwegian parallel corpus, the corpus that I built some years ago of German-English literary texts, they're all relatively small, you know, between, you know, a few hundred thousand words and a couple of million words in my case, and they're handcrafted. Yeah? They're put together very carefully by researchers who are interested in investigating translation as an end in itself. It's as a scholarly activity. The corpus, in other words, is the object of inquiry. The Eurocard corpus is a good example of something that's opportunistically created. All of these texts exist, and then computer scientists come in and they say, let's put this resource together in a way that we can reuse it for lots of interesting activities. It becomes a means to an end. There's still work involved in putting it together, but it's largely opportunistically created, and it's much bigger than what translation studies scholars would typically work. Okay, in translation studies, we've used these parallel corpora to investigate lots of things, like features of translation, translator style, some basic concepts, like what kind of units do people work with, okay? All of this work is important, I think, for political, linguistic, and technological reasons. For political reasons, because within our domain, if we can argue that translation is different from other types of text production, we carve out an area for ourselves. We give ourselves some kind of academic legitimacy. Okay, so it's important politically. Linguistically, there are certain languages where an awful lot of the text production in that language is actually from translation. And if translation has special features, then it could be influencing the target language to an extraordinary extent. I think of languages like Finnish. For technological reasons, I go back to the idea of contemporary technologies that reuse translations all the time. Okay? If translations have quirky features, well, you should know that before you keep replicating those features using technologies that we're currently using. Very, very quickly, I'll just mention a couple of findings from corpus-based translation studies. We found, for example, that explicitation, in other words, the saying, making explicit something that might have only been implicit in the source text, is actually a very, very, very common phenomenon. You see it in nearly every study, whether the study starts out looking at explicitation or not. We also see that certain types of translation show particular patterns of word usage. Yeah? And there are some words that are typical of translation and other words that are typical of text production in the native language, if you like. We've also seen in a number of studies how you can actually see the translator's voice, if that's not a kind of mixing metaphors, by doing certain types of corpus-based studies. In, for example, narratological structures, you can tell sometimes when one translator can tell you more about the character than the original author did, as opposed to another translator. Even typography can, you know, the use of italics can be an element of translator's style. In some cases, a translator might be trying to emulate a more conversational tone, and in English, anyway, they would use italics to give the impression of stress that you can get in the spoken language, but not normally in the written language. So what all of these studies say to us is that translations don't say the same things as originals, sometimes they say more. Translators don't necessarily say the same things in the same way as other texts in the same language. And what is said, how it is said, depends on the translator, amongst other things. So all of these studies, for me, point simultaneously to the specificity of translated language, there's something special about it, but also to the presence and the individuality of individual translators. Okay, you can see, and that's how we use corpora, if you like, in corpus-based translation studies. Machine translation, though, is different in that their use of corpora is based on an idea that comes from Pierre Isabel, that existing translations contain more solutions to more translation problems than any other source. Okay. This has led to the emergence of translation memories as a technology, but also to corpus-based or data-driven machine translation. This is normally divided into statistical machine translation and example-based machine translation. Basically, the idea here is that the machine learns from what the human translator has done. That's the simple idea behind it. One very good example of a statistics-based machine translation is the Google Translate feature, which a lot of you might already know. These endeavors, if you like, rely on human translations for their data, for their input. The technology simply doesn't work unless you have input data, okay, translations that already exist. They also rely on human translators human translations for their legitimacy. Because if you look at what people in statistics-based machine translation often say about their work, you'll see that they say our work is based on existing good quality human translations. Okay? So we recycle those human translations. So we can't get it wrong. Yeah, in some ways, not like old machine translation that used to get it wrong all the time, because it didn't have access to the intuition or output of human translators. This type of machine translation is onto a winner in some ways. Okay. Here's my diversion. This is where I get into metaphor. Okay. There has been a lot of discussion within translation studies about the metaphors we use to describe translation. One very pervasive metaphor is this idea of translation as a kind of carrying across of meaning. Okay? It's an idea that suggests that meaning is independent of languages and that you can carry it in a bucket or something like that. It's gone out of favour in a lot of translation studies, but it's actually still visible in machine translation research often. There are other very famous metaphors. I just plucked two here out of the literature. The idea of les baies infidèles. I'm sure you're familiar with this. Translations are like wives. They're either beautiful but unfaithful, or unbeautiful but faithful. You know, these old ones. The Italians have their idea of the translator as traitor because they sound so similar in Italian. There have been other more positive images of translators. Again, carriers. This is Francis Bacon. But carriers of light, not of content, yeah? Of light, light bearers. I like that one. Okay. What I'm seeing in some of the discourse from machine translation is the emergence of new metaphors. And I tried to depict some of them pictorially here. This first one here, I don't know whether you're able to guess what it is, but computer scientists probably would. It's this idea of translation as a natural resource. Okay? So we talk of translation mining and of term mining in English. I'm not sure what the equivalents are in French or Arabic, but this is very, very predominant. Okay? And the metaphor behind that is, you know, translation is some kind of natural resource that people with the right type of an entrepreneurial spirit would then go and utilize. Another metaphor that comes across quite frequently is this idea of translation as a crop. So we harvest translations these days in the same way as we harvest wheat, okay? You'll see this in a lot of pronouncements on statistical-based machine translation. For example, in Kwa's recent book, she talks about the goal of statistical machine translation being to harvest a list of possible translation equivalents. So again, we have natural resources, we have crops. My favorite one is actually translation as food. Okay, it's an extension of the crop idea, already processed into food. And you'll see this in pronouncements about Google Translate, for example. Och here refers to Franz Och, who's one of the main researchers with Google Translate. And this is a description of what he does. He feeds hundreds of millions of words from parallel texts, such as Arabic and English. I put the sick in there because, of course, Arabic and English are languages, they're not texts, but you get the idea, into the computer using United Nations and European Union documents as key resources. So this technology is described as being as relying on being fed. Okay. Again, Google themselves, the first quote is from a Reuters article on Google Translate. The second quote then is from Google themselves. They say, we feed the computer billions of words of text, both monolingual and text, in the target language and aligned text, consisting of examples of human translations between the languages. Okay? So they're feeding their machine. There's a group called the Translation Automation User Society. That's what it says on some of their material. I think it should be Users Society, but anyway, this is what their official material says. And they promulgate the idea of translation as a utility, like water or electricity, okay? And they talk about words flowing freely through a network of pipes, and they aspire towards translation out of the wall, in the same way as your electricity or your water comes out of the wall, okay? So, the question arises, this is the so what bit. Does it actually matter how we conceptualize translation, what metaphors we use? We have to use metaphors, we always have done, to explain quite a complex process. Well, if you look at more culturally oriented literature, of course it matters. So people like Christopher Larkosh have argued that representations of translators and interpreters in literature, for example, in intellectual and popular culture, that these have enormous power to shape the way the public's perception of the necessity and value of the work of translators. Okay? So he reckons it's important. Some of you might know a very famous paper by Laurie Chamberlain on the gender metaphorics of translation. So she writes about Les Belles and Infidèles and all of this. And she asks the same question, you know, does it matter? And she says, well, of course it matters, because in the case of gender metaphorics, that these are only superficially questions of aesthetics, that actually, if you see translation as kind of derived or secondary activity, it has important material consequences for payment, royalties, etc. So metaphors matter. Maria Tomaszko, who's another kind of leading thinker in translation studies, in her recent book has problematized Western views of translation, and in particular she's critical of this idea of carrying the cross, because it paints the translator as a kind of a vessel, if you like, somebody who doesn't have agency, somebody who isn't committed, engaged, somebody who doesn't have an ideological presence, him or herself. And she says that this undermines translator empowerment. Okay, so there are a number of voices who say, yes, it matters how we conceptualize translation. So what's important for me? How do the machine translation people conceptualize translation? Well, Google, for example, remind us that machine translation is done without the intervention of human beings. Okay? But there's an irony there, because it's fed by the translations that are done by human beings. Okay? Do we see translator replacement in statistical machine translation and in machine translation in general? Well, yes. Even though human translations legitimate their enterprise in some ways, They're always trying to think of other ways. Well, you know, if we didn't need human translations to populate our systems, you know, wouldn't that make things better? So they experiment with machine translating and using the output of machines to populate their corpora in order to create more machine translations. Those experiments haven't been that successful, to my knowledge. People like the Translation Automation User Society are also very interested in current phenomena like crowdsourcing, which has very positive aspects, I must say. But one gets the feeling that what industry wants is just not to have to pay for translation, even though they deny that. The Translation Automation User Society are also very enthusiastic about non-professional translators. So bilinguals, who they actually describe in one case as carriers, cross-language carriers, because they don't want to use the word translators. Okay? They want a distance from professional translators. There are loads of good guys, though, okay? In open source software, there are really, I think, very admirable efforts to provide translations for software interfaces, etc. Those good guys would normally name the translators involved, as well as the software developers. And that's very, very positive. Okay. I want to return to the idea of translation as a natural resource, or a food, or a crop, whatever. What's interesting here is that unlike a lot of the work that was done in corpus-based translation studies that focuses on particularity, difference amongst translators, etc., these metaphors cast translation as an undifferentiated mass. Yeah? So it's just translation. It's not translation by anyone in particular, or good translation or bad translation. It's just translation. I think it's really interesting as well that data-driven machine translation is so data-driven that the details of the processing don't even matter to some people anymore. So, for example, the director of research at Google is quoted as saying, rather than argue about whether this algorithm is better than that algorithm, all you have to do is get 10 times more training data. In other words, 10 times more source text and 10 times more target text. And now all of a sudden, the worst algorithm is performing better than the best algorithm did on less training data. So more data is what you need rather than more sophisticated ways of processing the data. So there's this insatiable appetite for translation, an insatiable appetite for text. Okay, I'm going to move quickly towards the end now. All of this is slightly worrying, but I don't get too worried because I go to seminars where I'm working with my colleagues in machine translation. People get up and make talks that, you know, that again promulgate these kinds of metaphors. And then on the way out, they say to me, have you got anyone good for Irish? Do you have any German, English translators? Because, of course, the industry is desperate for good professional translators. And we're seeing that increasingly. Over the last few years, it has been the case. This year, in an English-speaking department, so target language English, with German in particular, German, French, Spanish as source languages, we're phoned all the time by companies in Germany saying, do you have anyone? We're desperate, because translators are becoming thinner on the ground in certain countries. So I'm not too worried, okay? Having said that, I do think it's appropriate to reflect on what's going on in SMT and what, as translators, we can say about these activities. And one of the sources that I found quite thought-provoking and inspirational in some ways is a source by a Dutch scholar called Tauten Hooft. I don't know whether I pronounce his name properly. And he's actually interested in sign language corpora. Okay. So one of the things that he says is that corpus linguistics has been very much interested in corpus construction and management and kind of micro-level linguistic analysis. But in his case, when in the Netherlands, when they went to build a national sign language chorus, of course they were putting together videos of easily identifiable people in the deaf community. Yeah? And he argued that in some sense the corpus becomes like a family album. Yeah? It has a status that's quite different to any of the corpora I've worked with. And that this calls for a different perspective when we talk about the corpus. He says it calls for a digital humanities perspective, where digital humanities refers to the inclusive study of dynamic interaction between people, their heritage, institutions, and new technology. That made me think, okay, what does, for example, corpus-based machine translation, or even corpus-based translation studies, mean for the translators who are included? What does it say about agency, for example? Years ago, Alan Melby argued that machine translation would never work for dynamic general language because it lacked agency. Yeah? That is, the capacity to make real choices, exercise will, yeah? Ethical choices for which we're responsible. One of the interesting things about SMT is, of course, human agency is already built in there somehow, because they have the output of human translators. Yeah? Of course, that's not the full story. What does this mean for loyalty? You know, Christiana Nord, for example, describes loyalty as the responsibility translators have towards their partners in translational interaction, and describes it as a social relationship between people. It's not a relationship between a translator and a source text, it's a relationship between people. So how do loyalty and agency fit in data-driven and machine translation? There are questions that are occupying me at the moment. So what do I need, or what does anybody need who's working in this area? Well, one is new types of critical engagement. Following on the kind of digital humanities line that perhaps people in sign language interpreting are leading the way, if you like. One of the things that I'm interested in is how human agency is at the same time exploited but also suppressed in current technologies. One interesting way to look at this is to do a kind of a corpus-based discourse analysis of what people in machine translation say. I've given you some very comments from some very high-profile, if you like, popularized descriptions of machine translation, but there's also the more micro-level kind of publication that's done by contemporary scholars, which is worth looking at as well. And also, there are all sorts of new types of corpora where you can see translators' feelings about contemporary technologies, so forums, etc. And a lot of colleagues in translation studies, corpus-based translation studies, I note now, are also beginning to look at what we say about translation and how we propagate certain metaphors or certain myths ourselves. So that's what I'm moving on to next. And perhaps I'll get to report on some of this research at another conference in the future. So thank you for your attention. Merci.